But in her case, she says, okay, I'll take the fibroblast, the skin cell. I will induce pluripotent stem cells from that. And then instead of nurturing or deriving a neuron or a cardiomyocyte, a nerve cell or a heart cell from it, with FA, I will do gene therapy on the stem cells. And then I'll grow cardiac tissue, I'll grow heart tissue from this cured FA, former FA patient's heart. And I can use that for transplantation into the same patient who would have a much better chance of retaining that tissue without rejecting it because it comes from their own cells. So that's that. You can see it's a very forward-leaning, very aggressive project, but we decided it was time to take that step and support someone who would take stem cell models into a therapeutic approach. And it will be very difficult. It is going to take time, but that what we're doing now is getting our gene therapy experts. We'll start getting them together with these stem cell experts and see if our gene therapy experts can help them figure out how to do the gene therapy on the stem cells before they grow the tissue.
But may I ask you a question? Is it true that iPS stem cells lives are not long-lasting? I mean, that they survive little time?
I know of no serious issue.
So yes. Apparently, they
die
soon. They die soon, at least.
We have not. Now I don't know. I have not heard our scientists express a concern that, for example, we're already working together with all the foundations around the world to develop a program whereby we have a bank for these iPS-derived cell models, you know, so and in this bank they will continue to grow them and maintain them and distribute them. So I know of no serious concern that this would be an issue over time. Maybe it has to do with the iPS cell before it's nurtured into a neuron. That maybe you don't have much time, and maybe you have to handle it very effectively.
Depending on the phase of
depending on the phase, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it could be that you have to move quickly and well.
It could be that it can be still improved.
That's right.
To be more.
And I've already said more than I know.
Or so, maybe it doesn't last long before being differentiated. You know.
After that's right. After differentiation, then
it works better, maybe,
then it survives.
I can check.
Right.
So we'll have to finish also our interview. So, what do you think that we can say to our
viewers? Can I go over just a couple of other things?
Yes, sure. Why not? Yeah. Yes.
Let me go now to just a series of new approaches that we've begun to take. One is in iron sulfur cluster assembly. We know that the frataxin protein's importance in mitochondrial function is that it presents iron in the proper state to iron sulfur cluster assembly proteins, so that it's actually the iron sulfur clusters that move into the mitochondrial membrane and help transport electrons and so forth. And they're in short supply in our patients because of the absence of the shortage of frataxin protein. So we have one scientist at the NIH whose project that we're supporting, and it is to synthesize iron sulfur cluster proteins rather than trying to synthesize frataxin protein and introduce it so that it does its function in forming these clusters. She said, why not try to synthesize directly the iron sulfur clusters and get them into mitochondria. It's in early stages. We don't know how effective it will be, but we thought it was worth a try.
Who is the scientist working on this
issue? It is Tracy Ruwalt at the NIH, and she's a widely recognized iron expert, and she's been at our international scientific conferences and chaired our some of our sessions. So she's a recognized expert in the field. We're working with Dr. Sid Hecht at Arizona State University on additional mitochondrial agents. He would like to develop the next generation and then the next generation of mitochondrial agents like idebenone, 8001, 743. He's working in a very sophisticated way to see if there are new generations of those molecules that might even be more effective. We're also now working with what's called SNP analysis, SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphism analysis. In a nutshell, this is a way of trying to determine why it is that some of our patients with roughly the same repeat lengths have entirely different forms of the disease.
Okay, you can stop.
This single nucleotide polymorphism analysis is a way we think we can help determine why it is that some of our patients with entirely different phenotypes, entirely different manifestations of the disease, have roughly the same repeat lengths. I mean, our assumption has been for some time that it's the repeat length of the shorter allele that determines things like age of onset, rapidity of progression, severity of final outcome, and so forth. But then you look sometimes in the same family, sometimes in different families, and you see patients with roughly the same repeat lengths with entirely different ages of onset and severity of outcome and so forth. So why is that? Well, one explanation might be that they have small mutations, single nucleotide mutations, on other genes that somehow affect the FA phenotype. One thing we're looking at right now, for example, is that maybe the gene that's involved in an enzyme, producing an enzyme that interferes with HDAC inhibition or interferes with HDAC's work on our protein to silence it. If we could increase the expression of the gene that naturally is involved in keeping that HDAC away, or if we could downregulate the gene that expresses that HDAC enzyme that silences our gene, and maybe in these, if we look at enough patients that have such mutations, and then we see correlate that mutation with their phenotype, let's say we find a, we could do two things. We could find a SNP, a single nucleotide polymorphism in a patient, in a set of patients. They all have the same SNP on a different gene, and they have a milder form of FA. Well, let's work with that as a therapeutic approach. Or we could find one where all the patients that share this SNP have a more severe form of Friedreich's ataxia. We'd want to find a way of suppressing that or changing it. In either case, you have the potential of having a new therapeutic pathway.